Welcome to Prairie Fire. I'm your host, Sarah Edwards. This is a show about storytelling. So on this show, we're going to tell all kinds of different stories, mostly about the people and the places and the creatives of downstate Illinois. And we're going to do it in a lot of really interesting kinds of ways. Most of the stories you'll see on Prairie Fire will be documentary in format, so telling the stories of people's pasts and their lives and why they do what they do. But as I mentioned, we're also going to get creative. So we'll tell stories that might be fictional, or using animation, or unconventional storytellers, that really the possibilities are endless. One thing we'll definitely have on Prairie Fire is music. So we'll have performances here on this set and interviews, or we might use this entire studio to do something really special. I think that after we're all long gone, a good story is what we leave behind. So we look forward to telling your stories and the stories of this part of the American Midwest well. This is Prairie Fire.
She grew up beneath a starry dome. Told and scolded she would never make it on her own. Fighting fear and doubt most every day. She broke through the smoke and clouds and found her way. You could say she's like a prairie fire. You could say she's like a
We begin with a story of a woman in Champaign, Illinois, who's been making a lot of international news lately. She's done the best with what life has thrown at her, and she's thriving in a way that's really record-breaking.
It was January 17th of 1997. My mom, my oldest brother Jesse, and I were planning to go to Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. And we need to do some car maintenance and we were gonna see a movie. It used to be a windy kind of mountain road to get to Coeur d'Alene. And that day we slipped on black ice into oncoming traffic on a curve. And there happened to be a pretty big utility truck on that lane that we hit them. I was 5 and I was in the back seat behind my mom driving, and I had taken off the shoulder strap and just had the belt strap on because it was rubbing on my neck. And what happened is I just went forward so quickly that I snapped my spinal cord. I remember being in the car right after it happened and thinking I was getting really tired, and I remember telling myself, like, don't fall asleep because you may never wake up again. I was born in Burns, Oregon, and then I moved to Tico, Washington when I was 2 and lived there the rest of my life. Tico is a very small farming community. It's 800 people and it's surrounded by wheat and lentil fields, so they're rolling hills, very agricultural, but just about 5 miles east of us is the Idaho border, and that's the Idaho Panhandle, so it's northern Idaho, which is very mountainous. You basically see nature wherever you look, whether that's wheat fields or you see mountains in the distance. I was a kid who loved being outside. My mom always has had dogs, and so we're the kind of family that takes our dogs on long walks every night. We would always go bike riding on the trails. Swimming in lakes and rivers were a big part of growing up. The best thing my small town community could have ever done for me was treat me exactly the same. I was already learning life as a kindergartner using a wheelchair, but the bar wasn't set lower for me. I was still expected to perform my homework. I was still expected to go to recess when everyone else did. And my classmates still asked me to play the same games. So I remember rolling down the hill at recess. And so that meant I had to learn how to get back in my wheelchair on my own. I still was being very physical. We climbed the monkey bars. I did everything that they were doing. And I think because of that, learned how to creatively do it. In third grade, I was excited to play basketball with my classmates, but that was where I realized I had a wheelchair. And I realized that there were some downsides to being in a wheelchair. That was kind of the first time. I was the slowest down the court, so everyone had to wait for me to get there. And then it became a rule they needed to pass me the ball once before we shot a basket. And I felt very patronized, and I just really hated the experience. So I was like, I'm never doing that again. But that's why the next year when we learned about a wheelchair basketball team, my mom insisted I go, and I was really hesitant. But that day, I was around kids in wheelchairs playing basketball, and it was everything I wanted the year before. I just fell in love with that. It was so freeing that I was finally doing a sport on an even playing field. That spring, when track practice started, they asked if I could come. So I started doing wheelchair racing that year as well, fourth grade.
I recruited Susannah when she was in high school, but unfortunately she said no, and she went to a school in Montana instead for her first 2 years.
Thank you, Mark.
Set. But I didn't give up. I kept on her and was able to persuade her to transfer to U of I when she was a junior.
The University of Illinois has been a leader for people with disabilities for decades, and it is only getting better and better the more we understand accessibility and the wide needs for accessibility that there are. I remember getting here and I got an email or a text from Adam saying, "Hey, Suze, we're doing a half marathon tomorrow morning." And that was my first night at my dorm, and I was with my mom, and I was like, "Oh my gosh, I've never done a half marathon before." And I was like, "I don't think I can say no." So I remember getting here, doing my first half marathon. Afterwards, we went to get breakfast together as a group, and everyone just got to know me from there. I have been here 6 days a week. When I first got here, my goal was not to have a career in wheelchair racing. I just loved the training part. And I still mostly just love the training part. Now I see it as a career.
Scaroni's gone out in front.
Susannah Scaroni will come through.
And it's going to be very tight between Scaroni and Ballard. I think it's Scaroni who got it.
Bronze for the American Susannah Scaroni.
I would say that long distance chose me. I have a mindset, I guess, that matches, you know, this fitness capacity and nutrition capacity where I like to just keep going.
In my highest performing athletes, I have to tell them to take a day off. I have to force them to step back from training. They just don't want to. That's not the way they're built. And she has that characteristic. That's a common point of discussion between us, is that I always have to pump the brakes on her a little bit, just so that she can rest, recover, and regenerate and improve and take advantage of all the hard training.
I feel like I've got a whole toolbox. If things start to get hard, that I can pull out tools to try and make it easier. And I think that is what endurance athletes have, just ways of making what starts to feel hard a little bit more doable.
She really has a breakthrough in her performance since 2020, 2021, coming out of COVID. If I could point to one race, it was at the Tokyo Paralympic Games.
12 and a half laps around the track. Susannah Scaroni is all alone on the screen right now.
This is absolutely spectacular.
Susannah Scaroni's the champ in the 5,000 and a new Paralympic record.
Really, one of the more convincing wins at the Paralympic Games on the track in wheelchair track that I've seen for a long time. I mean, really put a stamp on that she was the one.
After Tokyo, 2 weeks later, I was training and I was heading east on Windsor Road, which is 4 lanes, and I got hit from behind and I sustained a burst fracture, 3 vertebrae in my back. I did not know what was going to happen. I was like, what is my life going to be like with this back injury? Because when you're a wheelchair user, I think you just, you're very sensitive to anything in your body becoming wounded. But when it was my back, I was so just like fearful that I may have to adjust my way of living. I had been arguably my best I've ever been at and had some marathons coming up that I really wanted to compete at. So very disappointed, but then immediately after that was so much thankfulness that I was alive. In January of 2022, I was given the okay to get back in my racing chair. So I started pushing on January 3rd, and from there, my racing highlights have been pretty consistent.
On your mark.
The New York City Marathon was a big highlight because I love that course, and that course is hard. This year at around mile 23 was very challenging. That day, I remember doing Amazing Grace, that song Amazing Grace, and singing that over and over again to get me up that hard part. I just wanted to meet it and do everything I could, and I just did not expect, we had a really good field that day, and I didn't expect to be able to go alone under the course record.
The 31-year-old American in total control as she wins her first Boston Marathon.
I have very effective training right now because I have had so many experiences, and I think that has helped, you know, make me be really fast this year because I can actually visualize a time where I'm gonna need a skill, and then I can practice that skill at training.
She's taken that success and really has become the number one female in the world.
I still think that the hardest challenge I've gone through is not the marathon, but is grad school. And I think it's because it forced me to learn. A lot of times as I was struggling through grad school, because it was something so different than anything I'd ever done, I would draw upon wheelchair racing for assistance. I was like, why do I love training and I just hate trying to write this literature review? And I would remind myself that when you train every single morning, you're actually doing exercises to get better and better and better. And now it feels easy and you like that. I needed to read more academic papers. I needed to perform more statistics. I needed to do things that regularly like accumulated and made it feel better and easier. And it took me a while to like realize that. There are many times, especially in the winter, when, you know, it's snowing and I would like to not push through snow. I love being outside. I always wanted to be a forester. I would love to be able to hike through the woods, or when I'm in Eugene visiting my family, to actually hike up the sand dunes, not get carried. There are many times that I feel that way and I just wish that I could walk. Those are also the times where I realize that I have been given a different perspective, and I am very thankful for that. And I will also not deny that if I have the thought that if I could be given like the chance to walk tomorrow, I would probably take it. But if it meant that I couldn't have what I'd had to this point, I don't think I would, because it's one thing to want to go hiking, but all of the many things that I learned along the way, I would never trade for anything else. And I know that's true.
But now I am found, was blind, but now I see.
Did you know that one of the country's only Zambian restaurants is in Champaign, Illinois? Actually, Mubanga Chanda, who owns and operates the restaurant, says it's the only one in North America. And it turns out Mubanga's story is as wonderful as her food. If you drive a couple blocks north of the hot spots in downtown Champaign, you'll find what may be the only Zambian restaurant in North America. Keep your eyes open, it's easy to miss. Inside, you'll find Mubanga Chanda getting ready for the evening rush.
I'm the cook, I'm the chef, I'm the basa, I'm the cashier, I'm the dishwasher, I'm the server, I'm pretty much everything.
Chanda is as surprised as anyone that she's ended up as the head chef of her own restaurant so far from her hometown of Lusaka, Zambia.
If my mom was alive today, she would be very surprised. My cousins, my sisters back home, they're like, really? You're cooking? Are you? I do not even remember you cooking anything when you were here. That's what they tell me. I was much more of a tomboy. I would be out playing with the boys for the most part. I was playing soccer. But for whatever reason, I think I had it in me. I wouldn't be surprised that a lot of people don't know about Zambia because it's a conservative country, very quiet. We are a landlocked country and we are surrounded by these other countries that were colonized by different Western countries. We have the Dutch on the other sides, the Portuguese, the Germans, the French. That's why you would find things like plantains. We have samosas from the Indians. We have fritters, we call them fritters, which is the same as beignets, which is also the French. That's why our menu, we've kind of like tried to put everything that we have because that's representing Zambia.
A staple of Zambian cuisine is a simple dish called nshima. It was the first food Chanda learned to cook.
I lived with my grandmother for the most part of my life that I can remember. So there was just the two of us actually in the house. Nshima is just water and cornmeal. My grandmother never used to eat nshima. So I was eating nshima and she would cook for me most of the times. Then this one day, she just like, I'm not doing it. I'm not gonna cook for you. I've cooked it so many times for you. You should know how to do it. Really? Yeah, so I got it. I got my stool. And I think I must have been maybe 10 years old. So I got my small pot, jumped on the stove and cooked it. The first time I cooked it, it was perfect. Because you can miss it. Yeah, I was so excited. The next day, I couldn't do it. It came out all wrong. Look, what am I missing? So the third day, and from there on, I had it.
After high school, Chanda worked as a printer, but she was frustrated with the lack of opportunities in Zambia.
I'm at the point where I'm trying to like establish my life, and it's Africa, there are no jobs. You know, you really have to struggle. So that is the best thing you want to do, is to leave and go to, you know, a developed country.
Chanda moved to Champaign-Urbana in 2000 and worked as a software technician. After work, she picked up extra money as an Uber driver. One Saturday, three separate customers inspired her to change her life.
So that time, I picked up like three people who were asking about the restaurant, African restaurant. Like, where, you know, I picked them up from the airport and they're like, is there an African restaurant around here? I'm like, no. On one Saturday, three people asked me about an African restaurant and there was nothing. So I picked up the phone, I called my friend, I said, you know what? Let's go ahead and do it. She didn't even hesitate. She's like, you know what? Let's do it.
Stango Cuisine opened as a restaurant in Urbana in 2019 and moved to its current location in 2022.
Stango actually means America, United States. That is just a slang name for America. Really, when we just opened, so many people that have been to Africa, Malawi, Zambia, so many people, and they were like, oh, we miss this. I miss Shima. Oh, I miss this. I'm glad you guys are here. My main ingredients are ginger, garlic, turmeric. There are certain things that I've just invented here. For example, the sweet potatoes. That's not Zambian way of cooking sweet potatoes. That is Stango. I do the cooking over here because I want to see the food come out the way I want it. Because that's my food. I'm gonna eat that food at some point. So really, when I'm cooking, I cook it like I'm cooking at home. When I start something, I don't want to fail. I want to go for it, and I don't want to end there. For whatever reason, I feel like I am still pushing to get this one major like thing where I'm going to be like, okay, I think this is it. This is what I was, you know, looking for. I'm not there, I hope I can get there. Because honestly, being in America, this is the best opportunity one can have.
For now, Chanda is happy to be a culinary trailblazer for Central Illinois and the United States.
Food brings everybody together. It doesn't matter where it's from, good food especially. It doesn't matter. You cannot say, oh, this food looks good, but it's from Africa. I don't eat African food. You can't say that. It's good food. As long as it's good, you're going to taste it and you enjoy it and you love it. That's good food.
Finally, we want you to meet Leah Marlene. She is one of the biggest talents to come out of Normal, Illinois in quite a few years. And in fact, the people in Bloomington Normal are just nuts about her, and for good reason.
As a kid, you have the dream of like, I want to be a firefighter, or I want to be an astronaut, or I want to be a superstar, whatever. Like, I always knew that I wanted to be a musician, and I just never really outgrew the childhood dream of it. I was born in Toronto, Canada. I lived there until I was 3 years old, and then I moved to Normal, Illinois, and lived in the same house for the rest of my life up until college. Growing up, I would absolutely love going on bike rides like out in the cornfields and just seeing the great big blue sky and being able to see for miles and just let the warm air hit you and just like smell all the farmland. It was just the most beautiful thing. Bloomington Normal is such an amazing community. It's a substantial amount of people, but it's not overwhelming. I grew up in a household of music. There was absolutely no way that I was not just gonna be like slapped in the face with the idea of doing music as a career. And I look back at early childhood pictures and like almost all of them, I'm touching an instrument or I'm watching my dad play an instrument or I'm just surrounded by instruments.
Make them go ah, 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 as you shoot across the sky, ah, ah, baby, you
are. I've been singing forever. The way my tone has gotten to where it's at is by me literally like mimicking other singers. So I would kind of like be obsessed with the singer and kind of learn how they did what they did. And then I'd get obsessed with another singer and learn how they did what they did. And then like after so many years, it just became a huge melting pot of all these people that I admired and tried to like pick up certain things and leave other things. Eventually it just became something that felt just like me and like not like any of them, but yet they all are a part of what my voice is now. In junior high, I was obsessed with hockey. It was my life, and then I hit my head too many times, so I had to stop playing contact sports. I really like started to lean on music just in that time to console me because my whole identity had just been like ripped away from me, and I was going into high school and I was like, I'm not the hockey girl anymore, like who am I? That's kind of where I started taking it more seriously. I just signed up for every musical opportunity I could and it quickly like swallowed me whole. My whole high school career, I was just obsessed with the idea of going to Belmont University in Nashville. So after I graduated, I went to Belmont and it was like a dream come true to go there. It was amazing, but very quickly, like within the first week of going there, I like just lost myself. I just wanted to do everything under the sun and I'm only one human and I could not keep up. I really ended up crashing very early on, and it was a very, very miserable 2 years of my life. After four semesters there, I dropped out and I came back home to Illinois, and then very shortly after, I really came back to myself for the first time in 2 years. I just had this idea of I want to go travel the world and go find myself and just go be free and reevaluate everything.
Where there's a way out, there's another way in. You can't close that door with the band-aid fit.
Shortly after that, American Idol actually reached out, which was the last thing I ever thought I would do at that time. But I just had this weird gut feeling that was like telling me that I should just give it a shot, just have fun, see what happens.
So I'm here to play the game and roll the dice. I'm tossing in my coins, just name your price. Here's my 2 cents.
The entire American Idol process was honestly just the most fun I had in my entire life. People's lives are changed by this show. I don't think that's gonna be me, but I've watched this show forever, and it's just really cool that I'm even getting to be a part of it at all. The last 2 weeks of the show were when you really felt like a taste of this is what it is to be a superstar. Like, you're flying on private jets, you're meeting all of your idols, you're singing with your idols. You're just in your own world when you're filming for Idol. You don't realize that everything is changing outside of this bubble. And then the last 2 weeks, you exit the bubble and you actually see what's going on.
Leah, you're going through.
Put your hands up.
I would never believe you if you told me I made it to the finale on Idol. That was the last thing I ever expected. The finale happens and a day later you fly home on commercial and you're just like, all right, what do I do now? You know, you really have like the rocket ship to the stratosphere. You just came off like the highest, quickest, most accelerated climb you could ever imagine in the industry. And you have to figure out what to do with all that momentum. And there's really no bridge from the show to help you figure out what the next steps are. You can view American Idol as my launch pad, and in a lot of ways it was, but it was the Midwest coming together around me during Idol that really was the launch pad. It was Central Illinois coming around me during that time that really made a huge difference. And so I think this place will always be my home. I love it here. I love coming home. But also just the people here, the fans here are just like, they're just like the day one people that have been watching me since I was 8 years old performing around town. So Illinois and Central Illinois will always have a special place in my heart. I don't want to be remembered for any certain thing. I think I just want to be remembered for the way that I make people feel. That's kind of the central like guiding principle of my life.
When we were creating this show, we thought that Leah Marlene's unique voice and her pride for her hometown really represented the creative fire and the spark of the people of Illinois. So we asked her to perform the song that will open every episode of Prairie Fire. We leave you with a behind-the-scenes look of Leah Marlene performing our theme song, Prairie Fire.
Say she's like a prairie fire. You could say she's like a thank you.